Hello and welcome to the show. Now, we love our property. That's why we do this job. It is a fascinating topic.
But how do you keep track of the market and make sure you get a good deal? Well, one way could be to head down to your local property auction. Well, there are property auctions up and down the country throughout the year, so you really are spoilt for choice. But if you're going to dip your toe in the water, make sure you do your research and choose wisely.
Yeah, let's see if today's buyers have taken any of our advice. Let's find out what they bought.
In a house in Cradley Heath in the West Midlands, Dion is buzzing.
I'm getting excited, it could work.
And in the village of Treherbert in South Wales, I'm feeling invigorated by my lot.
You step out here and... wow!
But in Swansea, I come across a more prickly property proposition.
At the back of the property, there is a garden, but right now it is bramble-tastic.
All these properties have been sold at auction, and we'll find out who bought them and what they paid for them when they went under the hammer.
Yours.
To the West Midlands now, and 10 miles west of Birmingham, is the town of Cradley Heath, an area that was the centre of the 19th century iron, chain and nail-making industries. Dion's in town to see if its latest auction offering is worth nailing down.
So I'm 2 minutes away from the train station, which takes you straight into Birmingham city centre, so the location is... very good. The property I'm here to see is this. It's semi-detached, three beds, had a guide price of £79,000 when it went to auction. Now, we're a little bit overgrown here. I can see here this tree needs to come down as well. And the curb appeal needs to be worked on. That's all I'll say. OK, so we've got two doors. Coming into the property, which is always handy on a few levels. Keeps the cold out, good security, keeps the heat in. Various stairs going up to the bedrooms. And you can see we've got textured wallpaper and some dated carpet. Coming to this dual aspect lounge, and it's nice and wide. You've got a window that end, you've got a window this end, and they're double glazed, which is good. You can keep that front bay window letting loads of light in. The smallest radiator I've seen in a long time in a big bay window. Oh, there's two, look. There's another one there. You have got, like, the second part of this large lounge, which is at the other end of the scale. Windows here that do need to come out. Could you imagine a nice big double door here going out into the back garden? That would work perfectly. You could think about maybe opening up the whole wall. The kitchen is behind here, but I'll have a look at that when I get in there. I like the sound of knocking it through. However, where the smell is gonna go? I'll think about that one in a minute. Kitchen time. Okay, so into the kitchen, and it does feel a little bit snug in here. It's completely dated again, like the rest of the house. Beyond that wall is the lounge. You could knock through there or look to open up this space to create a kitchen diner, and maybe even some sort of family area as well, which would definitely work. However, there might be a better way of creating that space. Wow, look at all this space here. Use this space, speak to the planners. I'm getting excited, it could work.
If you were able to get permission to incorporate this sizeable lean-to into the main building, you could create a kitchen diner and avoid opening up the rest of the downstairs living space to the smells of whatever you're cooking.
Sweet smell of success.
Okay, upstairs then, we've got three bedrooms and we've got the family bathroom here. It's completely dated, you know, brand new suite in there, and then I think you'd kind of be okay. I can't see any signs of damp or mould, which is good. This is one of the three bedrooms looking out onto the back garden, and it needs to be decorated throughout. We've got a box bedroom right there, more of a nursery or office, or maybe you'd squeeze a single bed in there. But in here, the front bedroom is possibly the biggest of the three. You've got a nice big bay window there. Obviously, it needs to be decorated. All this needs to be taken off the walls and off the floor. But there are signs of a little bit of movement here as well. Look at this. You can see that crack down here. Look at that big crack. So that is something that needs investigating. Don't panic, just get it checked out. So we have got an okay-sized garden here, by the way. It's completely overgrown, as you can see. Also, this is the garage that you get. If you want to use it, then use it. Get your car in there, keep it nice and safe. It's on your property. Or if you don't want to use it, knock it down and add some more space to your back garden. I would say this, though, outside space like that is very, very handy. Now, I don't know if you can see this. I'm getting the right place here. We've been this. Let's have a look. What do I look like with the green afro?
See what a local property expert makes of this overgrown, dated semi. We've invited along an expert from the auction house that sold the lot to share his thoughts.
It's a property that's typical of its age. It is in need of complete refurbishment. It looks as though it will need a rewire, new central heating. Cosmetically, it needs doing from top to bottom. There is also a potential possibly to go out on the back of the house. Some of the houses in the road have done that. Again, it's probably limited to ground floor only, but obviously anyone buying this will need to check with the local planning authority.
If this property were to go on the sale or rental market, renovated, but with its current footprint, how much does he think it could achieve?
Assuming the property is fully refurbished and with its existing configuration, I would expect to achieve somewhere in the region of £200,000. If the property went onto the rental market fully refurbished, I would expect to achieve somewhere in the region of £850 to £900 per calendar month.
And if it was extended?
If the property had the benefit of an extension to the rear, then it will add a small amount to the sale price, possibly an extra £10,000. But I think it will have very little impact on the rentals.
So the house is a little tired. It needs a fair amount of work. You need new kitchen, new bathroom. It needs a full refurb through the whole of this house. And there's a few settlement cracks as well, a little bit of movement. Get all that checked out. There's a lovely family home waiting to come out right there. But it needs a decent budget to turn it around. Let's find out who had that decent budget when under the hammer.
This was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
One, two, three, and go.
The winning bidder, who snapped up the property for £165,000, more than double the guide price, was communications consultancy business owner, budding property developer and mother, Victoria. This is her second property renovation, but having sold her first venture, she's hoping this house will kick off her rental portfolio. She met Dion back at the property to tell him more.
Victoria, nice to meet you.
And you?
Congratulations, first and foremost. Good project. Was it this kind of house you were looking for?
Yep, definitely.
In this area, do you know it well? Yep.
I live about 10, 15 minutes away, so I kind of know the area. I've grown up around this area.
Okay.
And this was the area that I wanted to buy in purely because it would be local. And I kind of had some knowledge, a good starting project.
Okay, so you could keep an eye on it while it was being
renovated. Yeah, essentially, and be here a lot, yeah.
Right, because you've got a decent-sized back garden, with a garage. Mm-hmm. You've got an overgrown front garden, and there's a fair amount of work in the house that needs to be done. In regards refurbing, really?
Well, yeah, the whole lot's got to be done. And that's kind of why I picked it. My last job was a complete garden exterior and interior, you know, overhaul. But I'm going to get the trimmers out and see if I can see what I can do.
And in the house itself, are we keeping this layout, or are any walls being knocked down? Or?
Upstairs is staying the same. This one, this room's changing. That wall there is going to be knocked out and to make a kitchen diner here with French doors there.
Nice.
And then this wall is going to have glass wooden doors to partition it off, so that's a separate lounge.
So is that your idea, or...?
I'd love to say it was my idea, but no. No, in doing the research that I did, you know, when... Mm-hmm. trying to decide what property, I noticed that in the local area, someone else has, with a similar, you know, style property, has done the exact same thing.
Great idea.
So I saw the pictures.
Great idea.
Thanks, yeah.
Here's my bright idea.
Some would say copying, others would say it was simply clever research from Victoria. Her other smart ideas include a full refurbishment with a new kitchen and bathroom and converting the old lean-to into a new downstairs toilet and utility area. Victoria has had a structural engineer in to give the cracks upstairs the once-over, and they reported back that there was no movement to worry about.
Budget, what is it?
Well, I started at around 25k.
OK.
And I think I'm now looking at around, unfortunately, 35.
Gotcha.
Because one of the mistakes of not viewing it before the auction...
Oh, dear.
..was that I didn't quite know how much insulation work needed to be done. But luckily, my family are in that business, so family rates.
Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Do you get involved? Do you roll your sleeves up?
I'll do as much as I can, but...
What is that?
Well, like, bit of demo and maybe some painting, but knocking off some tiles, that's okay. About it.
OK, so demolition work.
Yeah, but I'm not a skilled tradesperson, so I'll pay those people to do that work.
OK, so you'll get a team in?
Yeah.
OK, have you got a team yourself?
It's not really, a team. It's just a lot of contacts that I've sort of gained throughout my experience so far of doing property development, essentially.
OK. So how long is it going to take you then to turn it from this to the finished product?
I'm hoping no more than 3 months. I've technically done a bigger project than this in about 6 weeks, but you never know.
Good luck, team of builders. Victoria's in the
house. They know me now. They know what I'm like.
Come on, you lot.
It's the same people, so they're like, oh, here she is again.
Is she coming this afternoon? Oh, God. Get up, quick. Listen, good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
I hope it all works out.
Thank you.
Before we go any further, it's got to be a yellow card for Victoria. She didn't view the property. It's not a good habit to get into. Time scale of 3 months, I think... That's going to be stretched. All I would say is Birmingham builders, tradesmen within the Birmingham area, be aware, because Victoria is looking for a team and she likes to crack the whip. Good luck to you guys and girls, and good luck to Victoria. You can find out how she gets on later in the programme.
It's not unusual to have a little bit of rain in Wales. But today, the weather seems to be on my side in the Rhondda Valley.
Sometimes, I think we forget just how lucky we are with the scenery in the countryside that we've got here in the UK. I mean, look at this. This could be Austria, Switzerland, New Zealand. It's not. It's the Rhondda Valley in South Wales, and it is spectacular.
The property we're heading to is in a former mining village, which is attracting professionals looking to commute to Cardiff, as rental prices here, on average, are half the price.
This is Treherbert, a little village just outside the town of Treorchy, at the top end of the beautiful Rhondda Valley. I'm here to see a three-bed mid-terrace with a guide price of £27,000 plus. This is it. Let's have a look. So a pretty low guide price then. So what does that get you around here? Well, at first glance, a house that definitely needs a bit of work, but looks like somebody's started and done a pretty decent job so far. Very traditional layout. You've got the entrance hall there, you've got a front sitting room. It's all been stripped back, so you can see what you've got. Solid floors, so I would be a little bit concerned about the damp-proof course there. But having it all stripped back, at least you can see exactly what you're playing with. Then you've got the rear sitting room here. Now, I know I go on about this, but really, taking out this adjoining wall would create this massive space in here and would totally change the feel of what is effectively just a small terrace. So that's definitely something that I would consider. But then through into your kitchen, and actually not a bad size, to be honest. White goods are in the slightly wrong place, but no, seriously, it needs a bit of work to refurbish it, but it's a good size. And then very traditional here. You've got your bathroom and loo downstairs. I don't know if we could move that upstairs, but that is a very traditional place to have that. Ideally, you'd want to move it, because if you did that, then you could open the kitchen up too, and suddenly you've got this really, really big feeling terrace. But other than that, you know, in this kind of property, it is kind of expected, so not much of a problem per se, and you might be able to get an ensuite upstairs. So let's explore a bit further. But for a starting point, I think pretty good.
This is a solid house, and the floor space downstairs is what you'd expect from a terrace property like this. There are no signs of damp or large cracks to be concerned about. However, it would be worth getting a qualified electrician to check the wiring throughout.
Upstairs, it's got a really nice feel to it, especially on a day like today with all the sunlight coming in through the windows. And then you step into the bedroom at the back here, and fantastic views out over the valley, a real bonus, and doesn't seem to be in too bad condition. Again, it looks like some work's been done. And then down here, a bit of a rare thing, you've got this little landing area, which is quite nice, and then two more bedrooms, both of them you know, in reasonable condition now, work to be done, but pretty decent sizes. Now, what I was looking at is, can you get that bathroom up here? Well, I mean, there is a space here where you could theoretically do something. Maybe if you stole a bit of room from that bedroom to create some kind of a little, just at least a toilet here. I don't know, I think it might cramp the whole thing up. I'd probably end up sticking with the layout as it is. Because as I said, it's just got a really nice feel, and I don't think I'd want to tamper with that.
Even without an upstairs toilet, this is an attractive lot for a potential buyer. When it's cold, there's central heating, and on a sunny day, there are incredible views. But does the outdoor space take advantage of this stunning scenery?
So at the rear of the property, it's a little lean-to over the area just outside the back door. But you step out here and, wow, look at the view. Absolutely fantastic. I mean, I wonder if you could build some kind of a deck here. I mean, actually, the neighbours have done that. yeah, absolutely beautiful. But then down into the garden, and obviously this is in a bit of a state, needs definitely some work to sort this out. But then, quite interesting, you've got this whole area underneath the property. At the moment, it's just full of rubbish, but I wonder what you could use that for. At the very least, a place to store bikes and say, barbecue equipment or whatever, because you've actually got this little lane which gives access to the rear of the property there as well. So for getting things like bikes in and out, it's absolutely ideal. So, you know, it is a lot of property in a fantastic location. What's not to love?
Let's see if a local estate agent agrees. We've invited one along to get their thoughts and valuations.
When you first walk in this house, you do think to yourself, wow, this is going to take a lot to get back to a normal standard to rent or to sell. As you look around, the windows are single glazed, there's cavities in places, there's a lot of work to be done. So as far as layout goes, there's not much you could change. I would definitely keep the bathroom downstairs where it is, because people in this area are used to downstairs bathrooms. At the rear of the property, there's a basement. It looks structurally sound, but I would definitely get it checked, and I would definitely utilise that space, whether it be storage or using it as a room. I think it's a great space to use because you've got cracking views from there.
With the work carried out, what does he think the sales and rental values would be?
The rental and sales market at the moment are very buoyant in this area. So for rentals, you could easily achieve between £500 and £525 per calendar month, and you'll easily achieve between £95,000 and £100,000.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, this property ticks every single box you could look for when it comes to an auction purchase. Yes, there's work to be done, but that gives you an opportunity to add value. So let's see who bought it when it went under the hammer.
This was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
You bought it well done, thank you.
With a successful bid of £57,000, this three-bed mid-terraced house was bought by Darren, and his son Louis will be helping him out with the project. The father and son live over 170 miles away in Portsmouth, but the views here were too good to miss.
Darren, Louis, great to meet you both.
Right, you nice too. To meet you.
Congratulations. Tell me why you wanted to buy this house.
Just fancied a change, different bit of scenery. So, wow's it was.
Well, so you went from the coast to the valleys.
Exactly, yes.
Why this part of Wales?
It's very nice and quiet and very scenic.
Did you know much about it before you bought here?
Slightly. I've got a mate who lives in the village.
So right.
He told me about it, yeah.
What did he say?
He said, go for it and give me the big thumbs up.
What was it that he was saying was positive? Because I feel there's a lot of positivity here.
Fresh air, a lot of walking and friendly people around, really.
What about the house itself, then? What attracted you to that?
The price, to start with, first of all. So there's a bit of scope to properly make a bit of profit on it.
Yeah.
And obviously, because of January, it's normally quiet for plastering, and I fancy just coming down here and having a month or two just cracking on with the house.
You're a plasterer?
I'm a plasterer, yes.
Oh, brilliant. That's a jolly useful skill to have when it comes to doing up houses.
It sure is.
And what about you, Louis? Are you helping out? Are you an apprentice or what?
I'm just trying to do what he's doing with the houses.
You're learning a trade in lots of ways, aren't you?
Learning a few trades, really.
So on a day-to-day basis, Louis, what are you doing?
Ripping stuff out, plastering, putting sockets on.
Is it something you could see yourself doing in the future?
It is what I want to do, really.
So what's it like working as a sort of father and son?
Can be a bit frustrating sometimes, but it's all right, mostly.
Is he a good boss?
Yeah, yeah.
Is he fair?
Very fair.
From your point of view, Darren, it must be lovely to be working alongside your son.
It is, yes. Got three other sons, and I've taught a couple of others, my other boys, plastering as well, yeah.
So what about the house itself, then? What are you going to do to it? And, in fact, have you done some of the work already?
Yeah, we started plastering already and done some electrics in there.
So how are you coping with the fact that you obviously live in Portsmouth and quite a long way away from here?
Yeah, what it is, we come down here for a couple of weeks, then head back to Portsmouth for a few days.
And are you living in the house?
We are at the moment, yeah.
Oh, it must be a bit rough.
Mm. It is a little bit rough.
Sorry. Just
trying to keep the cost down, really.
Right.
Over a hotel.
So, tell me your plans for the property. What are you going to do to inside? What are the plans for that?
It's going to be a new kitchen, new bathroom, obviously, carpeted, everything freshly painted, finish off the plastering.
So what are the plans for the sort of area underneath the property, just behind us here, and also the area where we're standing, the back garden?
With the basement, that's just going to be fully cleaned out, get some doors on the back, and the back area here, I'm going to put a nice veranda on there, so maybe 6 foot out, so you can see the views.
Oh, wow, yeah.
And all this here, this be levelled off.
Right, OK. Create a nice little outdoor space to enjoy the environment, as you say.
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Any plans to do any moving? Like, the bathroom's obviously downstairs at the back here.
I did look around the space and I found it wasn't really viable to move it upstairs.
Yeah.
So it is going to stay down, yeah.
And knocking through the two main rooms downstairs, is that something you considered?
Did look at that initially, and I thought also it'd be good to keep it so you've got a nice little front room and the dining area separate.
OK. So what is the overall plan for it, though? Is it to do it up and sell it on or rent it out?
Me and Louis, we've not decided really as yet. Possibly going to sell, but we'll just see how it goes and see what the value is when the time's right.
So let's talk about the budget then. What kind of budget have you got aside for the work?
Maximum would be 10,000, really.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
You're doing a lot of the work yourself.
Oh, yeah. The labour would be ourselves, yeah. So it's just like materials, really, yeah. So around about 10,000.
Wow.
At the most.
You will get electricians in to do the certification and all that kind of stuff?
Of course, yeah. And if we need a new boiler, it'd be obviously a gas-safe plumber, yeah.
And what's the timescale?
Around about 3 months.
Right.
Maximum.
And then you'll make some decisions in terms of whether you sell it on or rent it out.
Yes, definitely, Martin, yeah.
Good. Well, listen, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Good luck to
Thank
both
you
of
very
you.
Much.
And we look forward to seeing how you get on.
Thank you.
Well, lovely to see Darren and Louis working together on this project. And those plastering skills coming in very handy indeed. How will they get on sorting out this property in the Rhondda Valley? You can find out later in the show.
Coming up in Swansea, I detect there might be some issues with this house.
And look at this! That gives a bit of a clue that perhaps the house hasn't been lived in for a while.
Back in Treherbert, have we found the perfect partnership?
I like teaching Louis how to do things, and he seems to be learning a lot from me.
We return to Cradley Heath in the West Midlands now, and a sizeable three-bed semi that Dion felt wasn't making the most of what was on offer.
Wow, look at all this space here. Use this space. Speak to the planners. I'm getting excited, it could work.
Yes, this side extension did seem to be wasted space. And it wasn't just this area that part-time property developer Victoria wanted to change when she bought the house sight unseen for £165,000 at auction.
That wall there is going to be knocked out to make a kitchen diner here with French doors there.
Nice.
And then this wall is going to have glass wooden doors to partition it off, so that's a separate lounge.
So is that your idea or...?
I'd love to say it was my idea, but no. No, in doing the research that I did, you know, when trying to decide what property, I noticed that in the local area, someone else has, with a similar, you know, style property, has done the exact same thing.
Well, it's never bad to do a bit of magpieing. If it works, then go for it. And Victoria hoped her imitation layout plans could be done on a budget of £35,000. And in 3 months, she would have herself a nice rental property to start her portfolio. Now, 6 months on, we're back. With a new render on the outside, it's looking crisp and clean.
Didn't really want to go back to brick, but ended up having to go back to brick, so the whole house literally was stripped. In this room, this was a lounge diner, but I decided to split this off into two rooms so that this created sort of like a warm and cosy living room. Then a major change that I did was in the kitchen. I took out the wall, which was making it a small kitchen, and then I turned that into a kitchen diner. There was a side lean-to area that was screaming out for being converted into something like a utility room, downstairs toilet. Something like that, so that's exactly what I did.
And upstairs, the three bedrooms are bright and light. And in the bathroom, by turning the bath around, she's also managed to install a separate shower.
I needed to do quite a lot of work to the garden, so one of the first things I did was put in decking so that there's something straight away for, you know, whoever lives here to come into. And a lot of work had to be done to the garden to basically clear it out and make it into some kind of usable space, which is almost finished but not quite there yet.
Well, the place now feels like it's got its own identity, but it hasn't been without its challenges.
So we had a few problems along the way. One of them, to the very start, was I tried to preserve as much plaster work in the house as possible, but couldn't do that at all, so the whole house went back to brick. I also had a few problems with the style of the roof that I wanted on the new extension at the side. We didn't quite have enough room to make it a pitch roof for the guttering, so we had to go with a flat roof. Again, it was just one of those, you know, problems that we just had to deal with fairly quickly due to sort of timescales.
Victoria also had to fully insulate the external walls, do repairs to the roof, replace the guttering and fascias, as well as all the electrics and plumbing. So this house needed the works, and that changed her approach to the refurb work.
So I wanted to do quite a lot of stuff to the property myself, but I think I was quite over-optimistic about what I could do. So I ended up bringing quite a few people in to help me do the bits that I couldn't end up doing. And I'm a single parent and I do work for... I have my own other small business that I run. So I just couldn't do everything. What I did do was strip the house, demo. There was a cabinet that I ripped out. I took the whole house back to brick with my drill. And then I kind of stepped out of it, brought the professionals in, and then I've come back into it at the decorating stage. So I've done as much as I can, but there's only so much I could do.
Work-life balance in property development isn't always easy, because it's also a balance between your time and how much money you're prepared to spend.
So my initial budget was about £25,000 to do the whole renovation project on the house, but unfortunately I didn't view the project, the house, before I bought it. So when I did eventually view the property, the initial budget went up by about £10,000. Then every job just became a little bit bigger than I anticipated, really. So we're now looking about £45,000 to £50,000 as my total budget.
Victoria still has some snagging to do in this house and some more finishing in the garden. So that £50,000 figure is probably more on the mark. And having bought the house for £165,000 at auction, she has £215,000 invested into this, her second property venture. So, money well spent. What does a local property expert think?
It's the first time I've been into this property, and first impressions is, yeah, they've made a really nice job of it. You've got now a kitchen diner, but they've also made it so you can open up the front living area and incorporate it into here, but there's also doors on it so that if you want to do something, some smelly cooking, you can shut it off and you can go and sit away from it after you've finished eating.
Having previously sold her first property venture, Victoria wants to keep this house to start a small rental portfolio. But in order to buy another property, she may need to refinance her £215,000 investment. So its resale value is important.
If the new owner decides now they've done it all out, they're going to sell it on the open market, then I feel that they would achieve in the region of £220,000.
OK, so there's really no profit margin on the resale market, but for Victoria, it's all about rental.
If the new owner decides to rent the property out, I feel that they would achieve in the region of £850 to £900 per calendar month.
Great. I've had an agent in myself who pretty much gave me the exact same figures.
£850 per calendar month would see Victoria get a rental yield of around 5%. And considering all the issues she had to cope with in this house, as well as juggling between jobs and family, it's all pretty impressive. So, what's her secret?
I don't really feel like there has been a big secret. I've just planned and organised as best I can along the way. I've relied on others. For example, my mum has looked after my son when needed. My son's also come here to help me out with the project, so I've managed to combine the two. Running my other small business as well has, you know, has been a little bit difficult, but essentially I think it comes down to sort of a passion for what you're doing. So I really enjoy the property side of it. I really enjoy my comms consultancy business. So it's, you just get on with it, really.
I'm off to the second largest city in Wales now, Swansea. Swansea was once a major centre for the copper industry, earning it the nickname Copperopolis. In the heart of the city stands the remains of the late 13th and early 14th century castle, a place where past meets modern. So will it be something new or something old that I'm here to see?
Well, about 3 miles from the city centre, in this really nice residential development, is the property I'm here to see. Quite interesting design sort of strikes you the moment you see it. It's a two-bed semi, £77,000 was the guide price. Not a lot of money, but then look at the state. I mean, straight away, the woodwork, not good at all. Let's see what it's like inside. So, through the front door, and, oh, wow. Right, this is the kitchen. It's relatively small, but I think it's made to feel a lot smaller by the amount of junk there. Look at this! That gives a bit of a clue that perhaps the house hasn't been lived in for a while, which means it might be damp and things like that, so we'll forgive it for that. But, wow, that's a lot of posts to open. Well, not much else particularly on the ground floor. The kitchen there, obviously, with a post. And then this living room area. But it's big enough to have a little dining room table. Some nice doors out onto a... Ooh, we'll explore that in a minute. But then this sort of open plan-ish kind of staircase. I'm actually pleased it's like that, because otherwise I think it would actually feel quite cramped in here. But, you know, it is what it is. It's only a two-bedroom property. It's relatively small. But you know what? I like what I see. Apart from that, what on earth was people... What? I mean... seems a little bit low to have a van.
A little low and a little dated. It's a no from me.
I'm your number one fan. I'm your number one fan.
So upstairs, not a massive amount of space, as you might expect, but enough to have a bathroom with an actual bath in it, which is good news. Needs refurbishing. But then one relatively small-ish bedroom there, and then, I guess, your master bedroom here. You know, built-in wardrobes need to be taken out. Although what you do with storage, you create something else. It is what it is. It's not huge, but it has a nice feel to it. And for a relatively small house, I think you could, yeah, do a lot worse.
There are some nasty patches of mould upstairs, likely caused by the house sitting empty for a long period. Ensuring proper ventilation is in place and upgrading the single glazed windows should help remedy this. But it is always best to get mould and damp checked out by a professional.
Well, at the back of the property there is a gun, but right now it is bramble-tastic. Oh, my word. You're going to have to spend some time out here, definitely. But it wouldn't be a bad-sized space. I'd probably want to get rid of these conifers. Interestingly enough, it also goes around the side here. So I suppose there is the possibility of some kind of extension on the side. Not really enough to do an extension on the back. But I think get that... get it sorted out, and you're going to have at least a garden. As opposed to a prickle patch.
It's a jungle out there.
Yes, I think any buyer should come armed with a pair of heavy-duty gardening gloves. But does an expert from the auction house who sold this property think it's worth putting in the hard graft to unearth this two-bed house?
There are signs of rotting wood outside at the porch area, so that would need repairing. The garden is completely overgrown and overall a complete refurb, new bathroom, new kitchen, carpets, decor, but then it's ready to go.
The expert can see past the obvious signs of neglect, but what does she think this place could be worth once all those things on her list are ticked off?
Renovated to a good standard, I would put a value on this property of £120,000.
That's not bad for a house guided at £77,000. But what about rental value?
This place would rent for between £650 and £700 per calendar month.
Well, don't know, but I really like this little property. Yes, it needs some tender loving care, but intrinsically it's in a nice location. It's a little bit quirky. I think it would be a really good one to go for. Let's see who agreed when it went under the hammer.
This lot was part of a remote auction with bids taking place online.
Well done, sir.
And it was bought for £94,000 by Chris. He already has 7 properties to his name and is a registered landlord. However, this is just a side interest for him, as he also runs an IT company. I caught up with him to find out his plans.
Chris, nice to meet you.
It means nice to meet you, Martin.
Congratulations. Fine. Tell me why you want to buy this house.
Well, strangely, I grew up about 400 yards down the road from here.
No.
So I know the area quite well. and I've got other properties in Swansea as well.
Right.
So, yeah, it's just a natural extra, an additional house to renovate, really.
An interesting one. What was it about it that you liked?
I remember these houses being built.
Okay.
Yeah, so they were sort of, you know, a one-off at the time. So, obviously, the design of them is quite, they're quite sort of attractive. From the outside. It looks as if to me it would have been a simple one to renovate. Really, it's nothing out of the ordinary to do to it. Just general.
It's just had a few years of not being very well looked after, hasn't it?
Yeah.
So a bit of tender loving care, and it should bring it back up to scratch.
Yeah.
And what's the idea for it? Is it to do it up and sell it on, or to rent it out?
To rent it out. Yeah. To add to the portfolio. Yeah. Just to rent it. Yeah.
So what kind of rental do you think you might get for this when it's done?
I would say £650 to £700.
Okay.
Hopefully, if I can put a good standard to it, I'm sure we will get that. So yeah, fingers crossed. Yeah.
So tell me what you're going to do to sort it out.
Okay. So obviously the garden is in a right state. That's going to need to be sorted. New kitchen, bathroom, wooden flooring downstairs, carpeting throughout, redecoration. Just a general tidy-up, really. If there's anything extra we can do along the way, we'll do it.
And how involved in all that are you?
I can do certain things. No, I'm not an expert in anything special, like electrics or gas or anything like that. But I can do. I can help with the decorating, garden clearance. I can do kitchens, put a bit of woodwork together.
Okay.
And possibly a little bit of the bathroom, help with that as well with the lads. Yeah.
Okay. But you have a team that you've worked with before that you know are going to do a good job for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I built up a list of contractors that I use in the area. They're pretty reliable, good standard of work, so fingers crossed they'll pull it through.
So what's the budget?
I would say 7,000 to 10,000.
Okay.
Might be a bit less, but I think, yeah, if I could aim for that, I'd be pretty happy with it.
And the time scale?
3 months. Three, 4 months, yeah.
Okay, and then get somebody in. So what about the letting? Do you manage that yourself? Do you find tenants and sort of do all that stuff?
I usually look to an agent to find the tenant. Okay. And then from there on, I'll take the management on myself.
Right.
So it's a little bit different in Wales. You have to be a registered landlord with the Rent Smart Scheme to be able to do the management yourself. So I'm registered and we'll take it from there, really, once we've got a decent tenant.
Rent Smart Wales was brought into effect by the Welsh Government at the end of 2022. All landlords in Wales must register and adhere to regulations to ensure all rental properties are safe and healthy homes, including electrical safety testing and having mains installed smoke alarms throughout.
What's the plan for you moving forward? Is there a sort of goal? You want 100 properties? You want 50? What would you like to do?
I've purchased another one across the other side of Swansea just recently.
Okay.
That's for renovation as well, not at auction. I'll just keep going.
Right.
If I can, as long as I can do that.
And is this your full-time job now then?
No, I work in IT services.
Okay.
Just over the years, really, I've done it as a hobby or a sideline.
Yeah, yeah. And will it be something that you would think about making full time, or is it working quite well as it is?
I think I could. I'd like to make it full time if if the scope is there for me to do it and the funds. I think that's the key thing. I think I'd love to do it.
Good. Yeah. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
And good luck with it. And we look forward to seeing how you get on.
Thank you, Martin. Thanks.
So, sorting the garden high on Chris's priorities for fixing up the house. He's got some good ideas and it's going to go into his rental portfolio. How will he get on sorting it out? You can find out later in the show.
Earlier we saw how one property got on, but what about the other two?
Yes, have they stuck to their timescales and budgets? Let's go back and find out.
We're heading back to the Rhondda Valley in South Wales and the village of Treherbert, where I saw a three-bed mid-terrace guided at £27,000. Internally, it had been stripped back to plaster and had a fairly traditional layout, with the bathroom off the kitchen at the rear and three bedrooms upstairs. And being built on the side of a hill, it not only came with the bonus of a cellar, but...
You step out here and... Wow! Look at the view! Absolutely fantastic. It is a lot of property in a fantastic location. What's not to love?
And that love was felt many miles away, as it was Portsmouth-based plasterer Darren who bought the house for £57,000 at auction. He was looking to undertake the renovation with the help of his son, Louis.
Tell me why you wanted to buy this house.
Just fancied a change, different bit of scenery. So, Wales it was.
Well, so you went from the coast to the valleys.
Exactly, yes.
And what about you, Louis? Are you helping out? Are you an apprentice or what?
I'm just trying to do what he's doing with the houses.
But you're learning a trade in lots of ways, aren't you?
Learning a few trades, really.
Yes, and on this project, Louis was certainly going to get a chance to check out all the trades with everything needing attention, from electrics, plumbing, plastering, the lot. And with Darren working on a £10,000 budget and a three-month timescale, he was going to need to get up to speed quickly. But now, over 14 months have ticked by, and finally, we're back. Property has been completely redecorated. There's new flooring and carpets throughout, and the windows have been replaced. Darren's back and here to talk us through what work's been done.
So, yeah, me and my son, Louis, we plastered all the rooms upstairs. We had some electrics done upstairs. We carried on downstairs, retiled the hallway, carried on through into the bathroom, a new bathroom suite. Got a plumber in to do the boiler, and all floor and throughout, really.
The layout has remained relatively the same. Except for one major difference downstairs. The kitchen has been extended by knocking through the wall into the lean-to.
So basically, there was a little lean-to here. It was quite dangerous. It definitely needed taken down. So in mine and Louis' vision, we thought, take it down and put the light, skylight in, and that'll let more light in through into the front room. And also then it'll give the kitchen, like a kitchen dining room area, really.
It certainly made the most of the space. And there are new steps from the kitchen diner that lead you down to the garden and the basement space.
The basement, I haven't done anything on the basement as yet. It was just a timescale, really. I will tank it in the future, and that will be used as a living space, yeah.
Getting to spend time working here wasn't easy for Darren. He was busy with plastering work, and being based 170 miles away in Portsmouth, the house wasn't exactly just around the corner. On top of that, they had a few problems along the way.
There was a big problem, actually. Me and my son, Louis, we put a new roof in and we put a layer of the felt on. We went away and we come back a couple of months later and it rained a few times. It come through, so I had to put another layer of felt on the roof to stop any water coming through.
Luckily, they managed to fix the problem. But what was it like working closely together as father and son?
Like various teenagers, yeah, they have their ups and downs. But I generally, on the whole, I like teaching Louis how to do things, and he seems to be learning off of me.
It sounds like they worked well together, but with the added problems along the way, did Darren manage to stick to his budget?
So my original budget was £10,000, and I ended up spending between £6,000 and £7,000.
Darren's done a great job keeping that budget down, even if it did take a little longer than expected. We've asked the estate agent who initially viewed the property to come back and give us his thoughts on the renovation.
This is the second time I've been in the property, and my first impressions of the second time I came here was it's definitely been developed well. As soon as you walk in, the entrance flooring is beautiful. The flooring everywhere else is lovely. They've kept a couple of the original features, but you could tell straight away, they've plastered everywhere, looks like new electrics. Everywhere is looking really nice. Very nice surprise as you walk through the entrance here into the kitchen area. They've actually put a skylight in, which is unusual. They've opened it up dramatically. Taking the window down, taking the wall down, the lean-to looked awful, but now it looks very, very nice.
It seems the renovation has made a positive impression. But Darren has spent a total of £64,000 on the house, so what could it be worth currently on the resale market?
Putting this property onto the sales market in the current condition and the current market conditions, you would easily achieve £95,000.
I'm very happy with that figure, yeah. Yep, it's good.
And so he should be, because that would see a potential pre-tax profit of £31,000. And what about rental value?
If this property went on the rental market today, it would easily achieve £550 per calendar month, possibly £600 per calendar month.
Oh, yeah, but I'm also pleased with that. I've got a tenant coming in the next few days, and we've agreed £550.
That will see him achieve a rental yield above 10%. Does that mean Darren is looking to rent long-term?
I'm still going to rent it, yeah. Obviously, £95,000 I could do a lot with, but I've agreed the rent, so that's the way I'm going, yeah.
So is Darren happy with the overall finished product?
I'm extremely happy with the project, yeah. Looking around now, I've achieved a good standard of finish. Yeah, I'm extremely happy with it.
And what are his plans going forward?
So my plan at the moment, I've got another little house down on the flat in the valley. I'm going to carry on getting that done, so I'm going to live in that one. And I'll possibly, in a few months' time, get another house to carry on the property developing. I'm more than happy working with my son, and we will definitely be doing future projects together.
We're staying in Wales now, but moving from the valleys to the city of Swansea, where a two-bed semi guided at £77,000 was catching my eye.
Interesting design. It sort of strikes you the moment you see it. But then look at the state. I mean, straight away, the woodwork, not good at all. Let's see what it's like inside.
And indeed, the rotting wood outside did indicate that damp was an issue. And there were some obvious signs that the house hadn't been lived in for a while, both inside and out.
Back of the property, there is a garden, but right now it is bramble-tastic.
But for IT company owner Chris, this £94,000 purchase brought back some memories.
I grew up about 400 yards down the road from here.
No.
So I know the area quite well. I remember these houses being built. Yeah, so they were sort of, you know, a one-off at the time. So obviously the design of them is quite, they're quite sort of attractive
on, yeah, they are.
From the outside. And it looks as if, to me, it would have been a simple one to renovate, really.
This was to be Chris's eighth property purchase. He'd put aside a budget of £7,000 to £10,000 and planned to rent it out once a combination of contractors and some work by himself had completed the refurb in hopefully 3 to 4 months' time. Now, 4 months on, we're back. So has Chris returned it to the new build state that he remembers?
The changes we've made, we've redone the kitchen and all the plumbing needed redoing, a new boiler. New floor coverings throughout. Redone the bathroom. Some new flooring upstairs, some of that was rotten.
Well, the inside is now nearly as good as new, but what about the outside?
We've stripped back all the vegetation and the weeds that were here. We've stripped everything right back. There were a lot of trees, as you can see along the border, that were encroaching on the boundary, which we've had removed. And then a new fence has gone up to re-establish the boundary, really, and it's turned out really, really well.
Yes, that's quite remarkable. What a discovery. This is a very usable space now, but if what was in the garden was initially unclear, the problems on the outside of the house were much more obvious right from the start.
So the front, there were big problems. The wooden boarding, which is like a mock Tudor style wood effect at the front, that was all replaced. We then had to sort of infill some of the cement that's the panelling that's between that, repaint it and re-weatherproof it. Obviously, new windows, which we thought we could get away with just repairing the ones that were there, but they were just too far gone. New fascias and soffits to the front and rear. And new downpipes, just a general tidy up and a freshen up at the front with some stone chip as well to clear all the sort of rubbish that was there.
Chris has helped with clearing out some of the house and garden, but with a full-time job in IT, he's predominantly got contractors to do the work. This can be the best way to get the job done efficiently and on time, but can also be a more expensive route to go down. So how did this approach affect his proposed £7,000 to £10,000 budget?
Spent 15,000. There's the main difference in the cost really was down to increases in the labour cost and materials, which was a big shock to me really. I hadn't realised it was going to be that much, but unfortunately, it is what it is.
£15,000 on top of a £94,000 purchase price does take Chris's total spend to £109,000. So, money well spent? What does a local estate agent think?
I have had a look around the property. The owner has brought it up to an acceptable standard for rental purposes. If it were my property, I probably would have gone a bit more above and beyond, doing things such as change the patio doors, skim the ceilings, and there's just some generalised snagging left to do.
This is definitely a hold-on and rent-out property for Chris, but is it also a good investment of £109,000?
This property would resale between the region of £115,000 and £120,000.
£6,000 to £11,000 pre-tax profit is not huge, but this house was always meant to be a rental vehicle.
This property would rent in the region of £700 and £725 per calendar month.
That's sort of in line with what I was thinking. I'd probably hope for more than like 750. But you know, that's perfectly acceptable. That'll cover everything. So, yeah, that's brilliant.
And even at £700 per calendar month, that would get Chris a decent rental yield, just below 8%. How does Chris feel about owning this house after seeing it built so many years ago?
It's quite strange, really, because going back all those years, when I first saw these being built, I didn't think that I'd ever be able to afford one, you know, at the time. But, you know, as the tables turn and time moves on, you know, things change. So, yeah, it's been amazing, really. Well, I'm coming back.
Property developing can be a steep learning curve, and there's a lot at stake.
Yes, the highs can be really high, the lows can be really low, but we'll have plenty more stories for you next time. But if you want to see more Homes Under the Hammer right now, just push the red button and watch on BBC iPlayer.